Yes, buddies, if you're ever in a situation, and God hope not, that you have to buy cheap carpet in the winkle.
In the winkle.
Well, that's coming in the video.
Hop in, babe, we're going.
Woohoo!
Well, your new friends from the Netherlands used to have a house left into the mud, but an old RV called Penelope, she's a 1983. Pictures and patterns of design. Penelope loves Robin till the end of time. Well, RVlicious, if you like a vibe, please subscribe. Please subscribe. Yes,
buddies.
My chair broke, so I went to the store. Mm-hmm. I bought the showroom model of this chair. All the chairs in there normally cost $20. Mm-hmm. It's like wicker material. But all the wicker chairs were already deteriorating. And this was the showroom model, and we got it for $5 instead of $20. And while we were at it, we also bought vinyl floor,
yes.
2 by 2 meters. Mm. Even Petra can lift it.
Yep.
See, I'm lifting it with one arm. So, got another do-it-yourself project coming.
Mm.
And all thanks to the client we had.
Yep.
We got paid. So this is what we can do for that money.
Thank you very much.
And we had run out of fuel. But thanks to the client, we could fill up to the max.
Our wheels are rolling again. Thank you.
And what did you just tell me?
And this is way more fun, getting your vinyl instead of waiting home all day for vinyl guys to bring the vinyl to you.
Yeah, in a house you have to wait, huh? Because you cannot haul all that vinyl yourself. We had to do that too when we had a house.
Yep.
We bought like hundreds of euros of vinyl.
Mm.
Now we go get our own vinyl, only 2 by 2 meters. And it was for sale for $4 per meter.
$4 per meter.
It was like $7.95 or something.
Mm. Yes. So that's an advantage too. Exactly.
It's
the color? Light brown?
Yes. It's not the thickest material. We're just gonna test it. How long before it goes bad.
Mm.
But for that price, you can get another batch,
yes,
if need to be. We got now kind of a situation.
Hmm. Our phone cannot find the GPS. So what we'll try is to take out the card. Whoa.
Yeah, the thing is, we got the phone, we bought it in 2015. Preparation for van life, we needed a phone to make a hotspot.
Mm-hmm.
And our phone is everything, eh? So connection to you guys, our YouTube family,
mm-hmm.
It's our navigation, so we can now find our camper spots with free power poles. It's the way we make create internet, it's the way we make upload videos. Is everything, and when the phone no longer works, it's kind of a disaster strikes for RVlicious. And now, a few times it had trouble finding the SIM card, So what we usually do is take out the SIM card, put the SIM card back in, like Bert was doing now.
Mm-hmm. Taking it out. Clear it.
But of course, smartphones don't have eternal life, and we've used this one for every day, almost 24 hours, 24/7, 365. We always have our phone on. Yeah, also at night when there's an emergency. We just pulled over at a parking next to the highway. We were on our way to Germany because there's a conspiracy of power poles, buddies, and in the Netherlands, they're very skint. If you put in, if you buy 1,000 watt for 1 euro, 24 hours later, even if you still have 800 watt left, they take it away from you. The Dutch power poles, they take it away, the power from you. What's up with that? You bought that power. You have a right to that power. But no, in the Netherlands, the power poles reset. You have to put in, you have to buy another 1,000, even if you only used up 200 watts, which we have, which we usually do. But in Germany, and it's a well-kept secret, I'm only going to tell it to you guys, but not to anybody else, so only you guys will know, right?
Yep, only the insiders get to know this.
Only if you watch this video, in Germany, you do get what you buy. So if we buy 1,000 watt in Germany, and they're even more generous, you get 2,000 watt for 1 euro. You get to spend that 2,000 watt. So if we spend 200 watts per day, then we can stay for 10 days on that 2,000 watt that we bought for 1 euro. So 1 euro lasts us about 10 days. On a lot of power poles in Germany is still power from your previous camper buddy. There's so much power in Germany, they never run out. The power poles are all sometimes full, half full, quarter full, and it all works for us. Because we have so little electrical appliances, we very easily we get more bang for our buck in Germany. But we have to be able to reach Germany.
Seems to be working.
This is where we are, buddies. This is where we are. We have 4G back, we have the Wi-Fi back. You better get going then. Whew. So this is my new chair. This is Petra's chair, much more comfy. I don't know how long it will last, but for $5, and what's sticking out there is a new floor. It was 2 by 2 meters, and it was only $4.
Per meter.
We only needed 2 meters, so
yeah. How is
it? The inner space is 170 by 170. This is the how it looks like.
That's what it looks like. So it's just dirt imagine nobody sees it.
Oh.
Neither do we. I wasn't good at all.
And if it's worthless, then we only lost $4.
Yeah.
So you won't believe this, buddies. But just while handling the vinyl, just by trying to fold it, it already ripped.
Mm-hmm.
And same here.
Except
for that. You paid $4 for this. We paid $4, look at this. What is this? So maybe this was not a bad rightest of ideas. But at least we saved you $4. Somebody's. This is the end result. It's like 5 minutes later.
Yeah. New another advantage of van life. This is the best and the quickest laying out the carpet.
Yes. It's we still got some pieces left. So we can use these to vent some holes.
Yes, but for
$4.
For $4.
Yeah, there's a reason that this is lying here. Beto, what is the reason? This huge crack.
But you made it.
Well, the thing was, that's another tip for you guys. When we ordered the roll of carpet in the store, at some point the good dude said to us, why don't you just head down? We just had trouble getting the roll of the carpet, the bigger carpet roll. And he said, go down and I'll prepare it and I'll bring it over. So now we're not sure, did we create this crack? Or did he crack it himself?
Crack it himself.
I think we did it. I'll take the credit, full responsibility
credit.
For it.
You'll take the credit, you did it, guys.
But that's what you know. You don't know with cheap carpet. How good will it be? But it's pretty good. We're pretty satisfied with it. It makes the van light.
I give it a week.
There are all kind of potholes and dents in the floor.
Yep.
That will probably show.
Mm-hmm.
So we should put in an underfloor. But first we want to test out the quality of this $4 vinyl. But it does look nice and shiny, I must say.
What do you think of the end results?
I'm very pleased with it.
Awesome.
So we fixed all the cracks with the carpet tape that we still had left.
Yes, let me show you the end result. Well, this is it, buddies.
Everybody wants to see what's under this mat now.
Ta-da!
Can you show them how you fixed it?
Yes, there was a tear here and a tear there, and we fixed it with carpet tape. It's simple and hopefully effective.
And for extra support, keep it a bit cleaner.
Yes.
We'll put up this
mat again.
Mat. This we already
had. Back, yes, it's back from.
The mat is back. I think we have a title.
The mat is back.
Mat is back.
Yes, the doormat is back.
So that's the thing with van life. Even on a low budget, you can do fun stuff. Is it to everybody's liking and taste? Is it high quality? Is it perfection? No. But you can make an error or two in an old van. You can just keep practicing before we do the real thing. If we have a real budget.
Indeed. So let's let's enjoy the summer.
My new chair, buddies.
Yes. Well, if you want, we can switch. You can take this one, and I can take that one.
So you can place bets how long before I crack through it. And the one who has the best, closest guess will get a nice present.
Yes. That's a good deal.
What is your guess?
Mm-hmm. My guess? Maybe a month, month and a half.
My guess is 24 hours.
Yes, considering the quality of the carpet, that might be true.
It's a $5 chair, so place your bets. How long before, because the weight, maximum weight was 110 kilograms. Mm. I'm a bit above that.
Bit?
So,
bit, he says.
Let's see. So our loud German neighbors went biking?
Yes.
Okay, and then we have time for a quick rant with Pat. So, buddies, what's up with that? It's not a pet rant, it was requested especially in the last Q&A video. So here's a little one, my own little... I thought you guys were interviewed by a student of the School of Journalism. And when I had his name, I googled him, I found his website, and on his website he wrote that he flunked his exams, and he was basically going for the second attempt this year, and yeah, that... I mean, that is one red flag, of course, if somebody flunks his exam. I never flunked an exam in my life, so if you flunk an exam and doing something you love, there's a reason for that. Maybe there's a reason for that, that you're not motivated enough, or maybe it's not for you, you're not cut out for it. But knowing this, having this information, and reading the mail that he sent us, asking us for an interview for the School of Journalism, he forgot to mention one of the basic things that you have to put in the information mail. He forgot to say, what is the interview for? So I noticed that, I mean, being a professional, and having been an editor myself, I've been a reporter, been a journalist, a company journalist, newspaper journalist, magazine journalist, so I interviewed high and low, famous and unfamous, and very complicated business people, CEOs, but also just the worker on the floor and the entrepreneurs. So he did not specify what the interview was for, and usually there's only one reason to not specify that, is that it's not a real interview. As simple as that. You try to hide the fact that it's not a real interview by avoiding that pitfall, because if he would say, well, I want to interview you guys, I want to take and ask time out of your time, but for you there will be no end result, for you there will be no end product, it's purely for me and my portfolio, I want to interview you guys, there's no publication, there's no magazine, there's no newspaper, I'm a student, I flunked the first year, I got to work harder this year, I got to build up my portfolio, I'm going to avoid this, and I hope that you guys are inexperienced enough not to notice that. But I did. I mean, I did notice these things already in front, before the interview even started. In his first email, he didn't mention that. Even when I was a rookie, if I interviewed somebody, I always told them, you're going to be in this newspaper on this and this day. Are you going to be in that magazine? And this is the title, this is the website of the magazine. This is my... all those things. You have to inform people what it's for. And if you're not, we registered that, but I did not act on that yet. And being half flattered by the interest, like I said, by of the young the millennials generation, I decided to go along and see how it would lead. I already knew I was going to be interviewed by somebody who flunked and who did not specify what the interview was for. But since I've been a rookie too, and I sometimes know how hard it is to get an interview, especially with two people living a mobile lifestyle, it's even harder to get them in one moment to talk. And knowing that time is of the essence usually in writing, even if it's not a real article, decided to let them know that we were like available like the next day or the next day or two. And then he said, well, okay, yeah. He did not specify if he wanted to meet us yet or do it on the phone. So I left it up to him and gave him the, so he could have said, well, okay, I'm coming to visit you right now. But he said, no, I'll call you guys. So this is what he did. And from my experience, an interview usually lasts, but that's real interviewing and not this fake stuff for your portfolio, school portfolio. But a real interview lasts at minimal an hour. You have to understand, being interviewed by most people, they never get interviewed in their life. So having a journalist or even a rookie journalist come to your house or your mobile home, that's a big deal. People, they dress up for that, they wait for that, they tell everybody, they get excited, they get nervous. So you have to respect that, you have to factor that in, and you have to be respectful of that. And it doesn't matter who you are, if you get interviewed, you have to respect that. And so I always did, I always took my time. There's no rule that an interview has to be short. There's no rule for that. Unless it's specified specifically, there's no rule for that. So if I have to do an interview where I only need one quote from somebody, I'm calling them up, I'm emailing them, and I say, look, I already written a story, I just need a quote of the mayor, and it just be short quote, and this is what the article is about, what do you think of this mayor? And the mayor says, okay, I can squeeze this through, on my coffee break, call me then, and then he gives me the, I give him the info, and he gives me the quotes. That's it. Then you know that in front. This rookie did not specify anything, so Peter and I took the time to answer his questions, and we know, and we have a lot to say about van life. So we took, because I know from my experience, an interview, usually a good interview, a depth interview, a normal interview is about 2 hours. 1.5 to 2 hours, and a really deep interview can even go to 4 hours. So yeah, it's a real job, people. It's not not to be taken lightly, and so we took. I calculated in that if I would interview myself, I had to take off at least 2 or possibly 4 hours. So we did. We took off the rest of the day for this interview, and. And he called us, and he asked us like a question or two, and we gave him, because I know what they're looking for in an interview, so I already gave him some bullet points, I already gave him some juicy stuff, yeah, very fast, but it was basically to warm him up for some follow-up questions, but he didn't take the bait, so as soon as I had given him some quotes, he brushed us off. Yeah, the thing is, if you're a good journalist, or you want to be a good journalist, even if you had planned to only write like 100 words on us, if we're giving you juicy stuff, you could say, hey, whoa, I underestimated this topic, there's much more to write about this, I could do like a whole series of follow-up articles on this. So one thing you don't do is brushes off and end the interview. And it was very sudden. It surprised me. It even surprised Petra.
Mm-hmm. It did. I'm still flabbergasted.
Yeah. And I said to Petra also afterwards, whoa, it ended before it even started. And but like I said in my intro of this rant, you have to get the feel for this. Yeah, if you're on the highway and there's no exit, you don't expect somebody to hit the brakes, if that makes any sense. You at least wait till there's a... A sign that there's a parking ahead, and you go there and you park there and you end the interview then. But you don't hit the brakes when you're on full speed in an interview that is just, we just had our introductions and a warm up and we introduced ourselves and he was already stopping the interview. And I could have said, "Hey, dude, we still have more to say," but that's not my responsibility. So I just let it play out. And we were both disappointed. We said, "Hey, what's up with that?" And he did say, I wanna come over and visit you guys. But the thing is, you don't know when that will be. Especially if it's a real article, like I said, if it's a real article, you're on a deadline. Deadlines are like attached to being a journalist. You always have a deadline. If you have two people that are living a mobile lifestyle and you have them on the phone, you have no clue when the next opportunity will be. We could travel to Portugal. Nah, after that phone call, we could have no time anymore. We're busy people. So that was really weird. That was a really weird move from him. And I let it play out, of course. And then he said, "Can I come? When can I come?" And then we said, because I was still a bit flattered, of course, by getting interviewed. So I said to him, "Well, if you want, you can come the day after tomorrow." And he was like, "Sure, that would be swell." And then we planned that. We planned that visit. And the next day I get a mail from him. "Yeah, could it be a week later? Not really best time for me tomorrow, day after tomorrow. Could we postpone it for another week?" And you're asking that to people living in a mobile home who never, tend to travel around. So we said sure, but already knew then that that's never gonna happen. I mean, we gave him like a whole bunch of chances and we were willing to talk, we were willing to share like we always do. And it was just clear that either he was lazy or unmotivated, I don't know, I cannot say, but I do know one thing, he's not cut out for being a journalist. And it might change. I mean, he might watch this video and learn these great gems of knowledge from a real reporter. And maybe then he's still going to be a great journalist someday. But you do have to have a little bit of a feeling for it. And the only vibe I got off of this is that he flunked the first year. He's doing it for the second time, but he's stopped believing maybe that he can do it. Or maybe already thinking about another career path. Because if you take it seriously, no matter what level of journalist you are, even if you're a rookie, a newbie, a greenhorn, an interview is an interview, an article is an article. You have to give it your best, regardless the topic. That's how I did it. That's how I became so successful. When I was aspiring that career, I became successful. I upgraded newspapers, I upgraded my employers, I went to work for fancier magazines. That's how you upgrade, that's how you grow, that's how you learn. And I became editor-in-chief of different magazines. That's when you know you're really learning. And it's a process, it takes time and it takes hard work. It's not easy, it's not cut out for everyone. And the thing that I didn't want to do is waste more of my time and Petra's time. He still did not specify what the interview is for. And so he cancelled on us, the meetup. So we said, well, that gives us a card to cancel on him. He cancelled the interview on us first. So we can cancel an interview on him too. And he cancelled the visit to us. So we can cancel his trip a week later to us. You get what you put forward. We were nice to him. We were ready to talk. He blew it all by himself. And that is the thing, my buddies. It is not an easy job. And that's why I said, if I'm interviewing somebody for the channel, that's gonna take at least, because that was, now we were talking about writing interviews, but having a YouTube interview is another, is a whole different ball game. That costs a day at least, or at least a whole day of filming and interviewing, because you have to talk in English with somebody who's usually not native English to talk, and that means a lot of editing. Editing out the, I don't know how to say that in English, it's okay, we'll edit it out later. That's a lot of work in a long interview. You have to take shots, shots of the van, shots of the interview, shots of the surroundings. You have to have full shots, you have to have close-ups. It's a whole different ball game. And then you have to have great audio also. So, and that all that takes up a day or longer. If you look at how professional movies are created, usually that takes more than one day. And it is a shame, but at the end of the day, based on that, ask ourselves, what do you have to gain from this? We don't even know what the interview is for. He clearly has a low interest in interviewing us. He did not respect the time that we took out of our schedules to reserve the whole afternoon for him by brushing us off after 20 minutes. So there's nothing more to gain from this. We already gave him too much opportunities. And but I decided, I said, well, maybe I'm too strict. Let's give him a final chance. So when we cancelled on him, I told him, I said, look, we just made a Q&A video. It lasts an hour. There's a lot of valuable information in there. I recommend you watch that video. And if you then still have questions, even though we cancelled on you, we're willing to answer those questions by phone. So let us know and we can do that. We're standing by on the phones. And if it was me watching that YouTube video, I mean, the thing is, as a reporter, is your job, if that is your job, you always have another question. You always have another question. It's easy as that. So the only right response to this setup, that was kind of a setup that I made for him, but I wanted to be sure for myself. So the only way to answer that is by saying, hey, Peter Pat, I watched the Q&A video, the whole 1 hour and 2 minutes of it, and I got another question for, I got a bunch of questions for you. So I do want that phone call. And he did not take that bait. He didn't take it. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have questions, if you just think, okay, I can find some, pull some more info out of what their replies to their viewers. Mm-hmm. Sure, you can. But that's not what being a journalist is about. Being a journalist is about having that other question. And clarify, verify. That's what the phone call is. You can say, hey, you said this and that. Can you clarify? Can you verify? Can you tell me more? That's what it's about. There's always that other question. And it is a shame in a way, but for us, it was content regardless. It's content if we met up with this dude or not, because the content is created anyway for us. The content is this rant that's gonna be uploaded. But that's the content. So in that way, he helped us, regardless if we would help him. We were willing to help him. I was willing to help him. I was willing to mentor him through this. Teach him some pointers here and there. It wasn't meant to be. And Petra, from the start, said, Patrick, you're giving him too much leeway. He did not say what the interview was for. Why bother to waste our time to begin with? And I was like, oh, Petra, I've been a reporter myself. But Petra said it.
Did I did. But does he ever listen to me?